morning. Thank you. mess that one up again. Should just stick to baking, I think.
Hamlet towns in Brunswick by famous Hanover city, the river western deep and wide, Washington's wall on the southern side. A pleasanter spot you never spied, but when begins my ditty, almost 500 years ago, to see the townsfolk suffer so from vermin was a pity. Rats, they fought the dogs and killed the cats, licked the babies from the cradles, and ate the cheeses from the bats, and licked the soup from the cook's old mail. Split open the kegs of salted sprats, redressed the men's Sunday hats, and even spoiled the women's chats by drowning out their speech with shrieking and squeaking in 50 different sharp slats. At last, the people in a body to the town hall came calling. 'Tis clear, cried Jane, our mayor is a naughty, and as for our corporation, shocking. Think we buy gowns lined with vermin, for dolts who can't or won't determine what's best to rid us of our vermin. You hope, because you are old and obese, to find in the furry civic robes ease. Rouse up, sirs, give your brains a racking, to find the remedy we are lacking, or sure as fate will send you packing. At this Samaritan corporation quake to mighty consternation. An hour they sat in council, at length the mayor broke silence. For I yield your eye my urban gown cell, I wish I were a mile hence. It's easy to bid one rack one's brain. I'm sure my poor head aches again. I scratch it so, but all in vain. Oh, for a trap. Just as he said this, what should hap? At the chamber door went a gentle tap. Bless us, cried the mayor, what's that? The corporation as he sat, looking little through wondrous fat. Nor brighter were his eyes, nor moister than a too long open oyster, save when at noon his conjuring muteness for a plate of turtle green and glutinous. Only a scraping of shoes on a mat, anything like the sound of a rat makes my heart go pit a pat. Come in, cried the mayor, looking bigger, and in did come the strangest figure. His long queer coat from heel to head was half yellow and half red, and he himself was tall and thin, with sharp blue eyes, each like a pin, and light loose hair and swarthy skin, nor tuft of hair on cheek or beard on chin. My lip for a smile went out in it. There was no guessing his kith or kin, and nobody could enough admire this tall man in his quaint attire. Quoth one, it's as my great grandsire, starting up at the trump of doom's tone, had walked this way from his painted tombstone. He advanced towards the council table. To please your honor, said he, I am able, by name to seek a charm to draw all the creatures living beneath the sun, and crawl or swim or fly or run after me so as you never saw. And I chiefly use my charm on creatures that do people harm. Mole and toad and even viper, people call me the Pied Piper. And here they go this round his neck, a scarf of red and yellow stripe, to match with his coat of self-same check. And that scarf's end on the pipe, and his fingers they notice were ever straying, as if impatiently be playing upon this pipe, as low as dangling over his vesture so bold fangled. Yes, said he, Pied Piper as I am, in Tartary I friend the cam, last June from his huge swarms of gnats. I eased an Asian in Nizam of a monstrous brood of vampire bats. And as for what your brain bewilders, if I rid your town of rats, will you give me 1,000 guilders? 50,000 was the exclamation of an astonished mayor and corporation. Into the street the piper stepped, smiling first a little smile, as if he knew what magic slept in his quiet pipe the while. Like a musical adept, to blow his pipe his lips he wrinkled, and green and blue his sharp eyes twinkled, like a candle flame where salt is sprinkled. And ere three shrill notes the pipe uttered, you heard as if an army muttered, and a muttering grew to a grumbling, and a grumbling grew to a mighty rumbling, and out of the houses came the rats tumbling, great rats, small rats, lean rats, brawny rats, brown rats, black rats, gray rats, tawny rats, gray bull plotters, gay young friskers, fathers, mothers, uncles, cousins, hawking tails and pricky whiskers, families by tens and dozens, brothers, sisters, husbands, wives, followed the Pied Piper for their lives. From street to street he piped advancing, and step for step they followed dancing, until they came to the river Weser, where it all plunged and perished, save one, who stout and truly a Caesar, swept across and lived to carry, as he the manuscript he cherished, to rat land home his commentary, which was, at first shrill notes of the pipe, I heard a sound as of scraping tripe, and putting apples wondrous right, into the cider presses of crust bright, and moving away a pickle tub boards, then leaving a jar of conserve cupboards, and a jar rats rejoice. The world has grown to the vast night sultry. So munch on, crunch on, take your nunch on. Breakfast up for dinner, lunch on. And just as a balky sugar punch on. Already stayed like a great sun shone. Gracious, scarce an inch before me. Just as me thought it said come for me. I found the western rolling over me. You should have heard the heavenly people ring the bells so they rock the steeple. Go, cried the mayor, get out the coals. Poke out the nest and blow out the holes. Consult with carpenters and builders. And leave in our town not even a trace of the rats. When suddenly off the face of the pipe of perk in the marketplace. The first, if you please, my 1,000 guilders. 1,000 guilders, the mayor looked blue, so did the corporation too. For council then has made rare havoc. Clearing himself in the groff hot, who half the money would replenish his cellar's biggest butter burnish. To pay this sum to a wondering fellow, a gypsy coat of red and yellow. Besides, quoth the mayor annoyingly, our business was done at the river's brink. We saw with our eyes the vermin sink. Once dead had come to life, I think. So friend, we are not folks to shrink, but our duty of giving you something to drink, and a matter of money of putting your coat. But as to the guilders, what we spoke of them, as you well know, was a joke. Besides, their losses have made us thrifty. 1,000 guilders, come, take 50. The piper's face fell, and he cried, no trifling, I can't believe that side. I promised to visit by dinner time Baghdad, and accept the crime of the head of his pot pot. All he's rich in, for having left in the Caleb's kitchen, unless the scorpion's no survivor. With him I proved no bargain driver. With you don't think I'll bait this diver. If folks put me in a passion, may find me pipe after another fashion. How, cried the mayor, do you think I brook being worse treated than a cook, insulted by a rival, with idle pipe and vesture pile. Threaten us, fellow, do your worst, blow your pipe there till you burst. Once more he stepped into the street, and to his lips again laid his long pipe and smooth straight cane. An airy blew three notes, such sweet soft notes as yet musician's cutting never gave the enraptured air. There was a rustling that seemed like a bustling, a merry crowd jostling and pitching and hustling. Small feet were pattering, wooden shoes clattering, little hands clapping, and little tongues chattering. And like foals in the farmyard when barley is scattering, out came the children running, all the little boys and girls, with rosy cheeks and flaps and curls, and sparkling eyes and teeth like pearls. Tripping and skipping and ran merrily after, the wonderful music was shouting and laughter. The mayor was dumb and the council stood as if they were changed into blocks of wood, unable to move a step or cry to the children merrily skipping by. Could only follow with an eye that joyous crowd at the piper's back, and how the mayor was on the rack, and the wretched council's bosom's beat as the piper turned from the high street to where the western rolled its waters, right in the way of their sons and daughters. However, he turned from south to west, to Poppleberg Hill his steps addressed, and after him the children pressed, great was the joy in every breast. He never can cross the mighty top, he's forced to let the piping drop, and we shall see our children stop. But lo, they reached the mountainside, a wondrous portal opened wide, as if a cavern was suddenly hollowed. The piper advanced, and the children followed, and when all were in the very last, the door in the mountainside shut fast. Good eyes they all, and no one was lame, and could not dance the whole of the way. And in after years, if we blame the sadness, he was used to say, it is dull in our town since my playmates left. I can't forget that I'm bereft. Of old peasant sight to his seed, which the piper old he promised me. Or he led us instead to a joyous land, joining the town in jest at hand, where waters gushed and fruit trees grew, and flowers before the fairer hue, and everything was strange and new. The sparrows brighter than the clock here, their dogs overran our fellow here. The honeybees had lost their stings, and horses were born with eagle's wings. And just as I became assured, my lame foot could be speedily cured. The music stopped, and I stood still, and found myself outside the hill. Left behind against my will, to go now limping as before, and never hear of that country war. Alas, alas, for Hamelin, there came to many a burgher's pate, a text which says that heaven's gate won't serve rich at as easy rate as the needle god takes Camelin. The mayor said east, west, north, and south, to offer the piper by word of mouth. Wherever it was men sought to find him, silver and gold to his heart's content, if only he could turn the way he went, and bring the children behind him. But when they saw it was lost and ever, and piper and dance was gone forever, they made a decree that warriors never should think their records dated duly, if after the day of the month and year, these words do not as well appear, and so long after what happened here, on the 22nd of July, 1376, the better in every sense, the place of the children's last retreat, they called it the Pied Piper, where anyone playing pipe or tabor, was sure for his future to lose his labor. Nor suffered a hostelry or tavern, to shock with mirth the street so solemn, and opposite the place of the cavern. They wrote the story on a column, and on a great church window painted, saying, to make the world acquainted, how their children were stolen away, and there it stands this very day. one day God said, this is what I'll do. I'll send down my son. I'll send him down to you to clear up this humpty-bumpty hullabaloo. His name will be Christ, and he'll never wear shoes. His pals will all call him the King of the Jews. He didn't come in a plane. He didn't come in a jeep. He didn't come in the pouch of a high-jumping bull. He rode on the back of a black Saskatoon, the blackiest creature you ever could view. He rode into Jerusalem, home in front of the Jews, where false prophets were worshipped, some even in tombs. There was Murray Von Murr and Genghis Khan, one you could worship taking a snooze. And Christ spoke from a mound, which is a pile of ground. The people gathered around, but making a sound. Thus he spake, sitting soft, socks full of sin. How shall we quiet this Jehovah-y din? Do unto others as others do unto you. That includes you, Timothy, too. And one Pharisee said to another he knew, what shall we do about this man, Jew? Wash him in wine and make him all clean, and in him set up Fiddle's crucifixion machine. Twirl the whirl and release the gavise, and in go the nails as fast as you please. And then it said, he said as he bled, forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do, because they walk through this world wearing two crappity shoes. Amen. Then, if it should be the will of its inquisitor, the liberty to die. Where are you when I'm alone? The riptide current of the riot. Hamlet towns in Brunswick by famous Hanover City, with the river western deep and wide, washed to the wall on the southern side, a pleasanter spot you never spied. How when begins my thinking, almost 500 years ago, to see the townsfolk suffer so from burning from the pity. Rats, they fought the dogs and killed the cats, and did the babies in the cradles, and ate the cheese from the vats, and licked the soup from the crystal of ladles. Put on the steak and salt and scraps, by drowning out their speaking with shrieking and squeaking in 50 different sharps and flats. At last, people in a body to the town hall came talking. 'Tis clear that day, our mayor's annoyed, and as for our corporation, shocking, think we buy gown and blind for vermin, for dolts who can't or won't determine what's best to rid us out of our vermin. You hope because you're old and obese, to find the furry civic world's ease. Rouse up, sirs, give your brains a racking. Find the remedy we are lacking, or sure as fate will send you packing. At this merry corporation quake of mighty consternation. Now in the Saxon council, at length the mayor broke silence. Before Gilder eyed my early gown and cell, I wish I were a mile hence. It's easy to bid one crack and drink. I'm sure my forehead aches again. I scratch it so that all is vain. Oh, for a trap, a trap, a trap. This he said this one should have. At the chamber door, but a gentle tap. Bless us, cried the mayor, what's that? With the corporation as he sat, looking a little through the mirror's back. Nor brighter were his eyes, nor moister, than a too long open oyster. Save when I knew his paunch for mucus, or plate of transformation mucus. Only a scraping of shoes on the mat, anything like the sound of a rat makes my heart a bit of hat. Come in, cried the mayor, looking bitter, and in did come the stranger figures. His long queer coat revealed ahead, was half yellow and half red, and he himself was tall and thin, with sharp blue eyes pinched like a pin, and light loose hair and torn skin, nor tuft of hair on cheek, nor beard on chin, while lips were spile and out and in. There was no guessing his kith or kin, nobody could enough admire this tall man in his quaint attire. Told one, it's as my great grandsire, starting up with a chunk of human skull, I thought this way to this painted tombstone. Advance towards the council table, but please, your honor, said he, I am able, by means of secret charm to draw, all the creatures beneath the sun, that crawl or swim or fly or run, after me so as you never saw. And I chiefly use my charm on creatures that do people harm. Mole and toad and human piper, the people call me the Pied Piper, and here they know this on his neck, a scarf of red and yellow stripe, the magic has thrown itself in check, and that scarf's end come a pipe. His fingers ate him as forever strained, as if impatient to be playing upon this pipe, as low and dangled over his vexed so old fangled. Yes, said he, Pied Piper as I am, in Tartary I fred the camp. Last June to huge swarms of gnats, I eased in Asia the Nizam, of the monster's brood vampire bats. And as for what your brain bewilders, if I rid you down the rats, will you give me 1,000 guilders? 50,000 was the exclamation of the Scottish Fair Corporation. Into the street the piper stepped, smiling first a little smile, as if he knew what magic slept. He was quiet quite a while. Like a musical adept, rolled his pipe, his lips he wrinkled, and green and blue his sharp eyes twinkled, like a candle flame where salt is sprinkled. And ere three shrill notes the pipe uttered, he heard as if an army mutter, the muttering grew to grumbling. The grumbling grew to mighty rumbling, and out of the houses came the rats rumbling. Great rats, small rats, lean rats, brawny rats, brown rats, black rats, gray rats, tawny rats, grave old potters, gay young friskers, fathers, mothers, uncles, cousins, cocks and tails and pricking whiskers, families by tens and thousands, brothers, sisters, husbands, wives, all the Pied Piper for their lives. Street to street he piped advancing, and step to step he followed dancing, until they came to the river Weser, where it all plunged and perished, save one whose scouts, Julius Caesar, swam across the lake to carry, as he the grand script he cherished, do rat ran home his commentary, which was, after the school rose up the pipe, I heard a sound as a scraping train, the playing apples wondrous bright, into the side of Preston's branch, the moving away of pickle cup boards, and leaving a jar of constant cupboards, and drawing the corks of train oil flask, and breaking with the butter cask, and seeing lift voice sweeter far than by hearken by solemnly and green, called out old rats rejoice, the world has grown to a vast dry sultry, So munch on, crunch on, take your gunch on. Breakfast, supper, dinner, lunch on. Adjust the wealthy ship to punch on. Always stay for the great sun shone. Grace is scarce in each before me. Just the thought that said come for me. I found the western road over me. You should have heard the hands of people. Ring the bells till they walk the steeple. Go, cried the mare, get on the poles. Poke up the nests and block up the holes. Consult with carpenters and builders. And leave in our town not even a trace of the rats. When suddenly up the face of Piper perked in the marketplace. The first be pleased, 1,000 guilders. 1,000 guilders, mare looked blue, so did the corporation too. For council dinners made rare havoc, with Clary Mosel, made of the broad hawk. And half the money wouldn't be punished, their seller's biggest bun British. The same as some dill wondering fellow, the gypsy coat bright and yellow. Besides, both the mare and the our business was done at the river's brink. We saw with our eyes the burning thing. What's dead can't come to life, I think. So, friend, we're not fools to drink. From our duty of giving you something to drink, the matter of money to put in your coat. But as for the gilders, what we spoke of them, as you well know, was a joke. Besides, our losses have made us 50. 1,000 guilders, come, take 50. The piper's face fell on each tribe. No trifling, I can't wait beside. I promise to visit by dinner time, Baghdad. And accept the promise of the hen coops by Taj. Holy is witching, for having left in the Caleb's kitchen. Of this, the scorpion is no survivor. With him, I prove no bargain driver. With you, don't think I'll bait a stiver. And folks who put me in a passion may find me pipe after another fashion. How, cried the mayor, you think I brook, being worse treated than a cook, insulted by a rival, with idle pipe and vegetable title. Threaten us, fellow, do your worst, pull your pipe for 20 verst. Once more he stepped into the street, and to his lips again laid his long pipe of smooth straight cane. An airy blew three notes, such sweet soft notes that yet musicians cunning never gave the enraptured air. There was a rustling, a seamless bustling, a very crowd jostling, a pitching and hustling, small feet were pattering, wooden shoes clattering, little heads clapping, and little tongues chattering, and like foals in a farmyard when barley is scattering, out came the children running, all the little boys and girls. With rosy cheeks and flax and curls, and sparkling eyes and teeth like pearls. Tripping and skipping run merrily after, the wonderful music was shouting and laughter. The mare was dumb and the council stood, as if they were changed into blocks of wood. Unable to move a step or cry, to the children merrily skipping by, could only follow with an eye that joyous crowd of the piper's back, and how the mare was on the rack, and the wretched council looked. As the piper turned from the high street to where the western rolled its waters, right in the way of their sons and daughters. However, he turned from south to west, and to Gobbleburg Hill his steps addressed. And after him the children pressed, great was the joy in every breast. He never could cross the mighty park. He forced let the piping drop, and we shall see our children stop. One moment they reached the mountainside, a wondrous portal opened wide, as if a cavern was suddenly hollowed. The piper advanced and children followed, and when all were into the very last, the door in the mountainside shut fast. Did I say all, oh, no one was lame, they could not dance the whole of the way. And in after years, if you would blame the sadness, it was used to say, it is dull in our town since my playmates left. I can't forget that I'm bereft of all the pleasant sights they see, which the piper also promised me. For he led us, he said, to a joyous land, joining the town just at hand, where waters gushed and fruit trees grew. Flowers put forth a fairer hue, and everything was strange and new. Sparrows brighted the peacock here, and the dogs outran our fellow deer, and honeybees had lost their stings, horses were born with eagle's wings, and just as I became assured, my lame foot would be speedily cured. The music stopped, and I stood still, and found myself outside the hill, left behind against my will, to go now, limping as before, and never hear of that country more. Alas, alas, for Hamlet, the king of many a murderous fate, the text which says that heaven is deep, hopes to the rich and at an easy rate, as the needle's eye takes the Hamlet. The fair said east, west, north, and south, to offer the piper by word of mouth, wherever it was men's lot to find him, silver and gold to his heart's content, if only he'd return the way he went, to bring the children behind him. But when they saw 'twas lost endeavor, the piper and dancers were gone forever, they made a decree of lawyers never, should think their records dated duly, if after the day of the month and year, these